Ba-da-ba-ba.
Ba-da-ba-ba.
All right.
This is Andrea Johnson from ICM Partners, and you're listening to Promoter 101.
And now, congregation, I would ask you all to please open your hymnals to page 85.
It's Promoter 101.
Blessed be thy podcast.
You may all be seated. It's episode 85 of Promoter 101. Welcome to our universe.
I love the opening hymn and organ theme song for us little goys here in the business here, Dan. Welcome to episode 85 of Promoter 101. We've got the record biz icon, Harvey Leeds, and the crystal pistol himself from William Morris Endeavor, Mr. Henry Glascock, to give his view of the industry. Plus, we've got an amazing war story from Live Nation Global's touring Omar Al-joulani.
Plus, we're going to break down the news with Oakview Group's Ray Waddell.
Hello there, Andy Summers from APA and Promoter 101. Happy to be here.
Come see us live in person. Promoter 101's recording in a town near you.
A little less than 2 months now, I'll be in Toronto, Canada. That's right. I said Canada.
Canada.
Which I believe is the word of the day, Luke. And when you hear the word of the day, scream real loud.
Canada.
Yeah! Anyway, Canada, July 24th, that's a Tuesday, IAVM's Venue Connect 2018. It's the promoter agent panel, talking Brian Hill, talking Ralph James, Jason Zink, Charlie Goldstone, Riley O'Connor, and little old me. It's going to be great.
Is this an early day conference? Do you have your timing yet set for IAVM, Dan?
Why, yes, Luke, I happen to know that that's at 4:45 p.m. in the afternoon, leading directly right into a cocktail hour. So if we're not good and frothy when we're done, we certainly should be by the time we're done with the cocktail party.
Want to tell us something? Just reach out. Hit us at steiny@promoter101.net. That email hits both Dan and I.
And you can follow us on Twitter. Luke is W. Luke Pierce. I'm at The Jew. And the show is Promoters 101. That's plural, of course.
Hey, this is Brian O'Connell with Live Nation, and we are on Promoter 101.
If you've missed any of our past podcasts, well, that's just your dumb luck. But hey, this week, we're reissuing episode 43.
Episode 43 is a jam-packed episode, including feature interviews from United Talent Agency J-Bo Lewis, talking about the future of his agency.
Followed by two of Toronto's most iconic promoters from Embrace, Stephen Riff, a.k.a. Riff, and the Horseshoe Taverns, Jeff Cohen, talking about the challenge of their marketplace of Toronto, Canada. Canada!
Canada. Drink.
Drink real loud.
Plus, in episode 43, we scored an interview with Agent versus Promoter. Those are the masterminds behind the very famous Instagram account. That's Paradigm's Joe Atamian. And then Majestic Lives, now Frank Brothers, now Live Nations, Scott Leslie, who finally broke their silence about the long-running prank and Instagram account.
And don't you think, well, you should just subscribe already. How many time we got to ask? Just subscribe and we'll stop asking.
It's just a button. If you subscribe today, we will stop asking. Just subscribe right now.
Hello, it's Kevin Lyman from the Vans Warped Tour, and you're on Promoter 101.
News of the week.
Ray Waddell's about to join us for the news of the week from Oakview Group. But before we do that, the hottest story right now is the number one show on network TV getting canceled off the velocity of a single tweet. Luke, have you ever seen anything like this? Obviously talking about Roseanne Barr and the Roseanne Show.
Yeah, I mean, it was a pretty repugnant tweet. Let's be clear about that. Roseanne Barr equating former Obama aide and senior advisor Valerie Jarrett to an ape. Pretty repugnant, but no, with the velocity downward in terms of going from top of a network ratings to canceled in 24 hours, I think that's the Chuck Yeager of cancellations there. I think breaking, you know, speed records there by a huge margin. And Dan, let me just say this. I know that Roseanne apologized to Valerie Jarrett, but based on the way that she was tweeting about stuff, you know, something makes me think that she wasn't really sincere about her apology. I don't know.
She is a comic, and she said it was a joke. It doesn't seem like anybody's buying that.
Of course no one's buying it. She retweeted Janice Dean and Steve Doocy from Fox and Friends like immediately afterwards. So no, Roseanne doesn't care about that shit. She was going to put up a tour and cancel it anyways. I mean, how do we really feel about this?
Historically, she postpones and makes those dates up when she cancels. But yes, the odds are if you buy a date, it most likely was going away. I'm under the impression there weren't a lot of confirmed dates right now anyway, and clearly there won't be because ICM is out of there as well. They were quick to get out of there, just like Disney. And I think this is a new day and age that it won't be tolerated.
This is a new level of velocity, though, for a network cancellation at this size and scale, especially considering how much of Roseanne's base was really ignited and maybe as the crossover of Trump's base as well, too. For her to make this kind of comment and kind of be held accountable, I think symbolizes a shift in some public thinking, which is a good thing, in my mind at least. I'm sure there's half the country or 35% of the country out there that's certainly going to disagree with me. But based on the way that this came to pass, no surprise that this show was canceled. My favorite part about yesterday, though, Dan, was the 90s sitcom celebrity shade being thrown by Julia Louis-Dreyfus, who was, of course, on the air in the 90s while Roseanne was, on Seinfeld, posting a photo with Valerie Jarrett saying, "My best friend at Valerie Jarrett." It was pretty good yesterday. That's some world-class celebrity shade right there.
Hollywood Reporter just posted, this was just handed off to me, that in the aftermath, the stars that expect to get paid, Sailor Gilbert, John Goodman, Laurie Metcalf are all expected to be paid for the scrap season. So that's pretty impressive. I'm not sure how they decide who does and who doesn't get paid. It may have been how the contracts read in advance, and clearly they're the bigger stars. So that may have had something to do with that. But this is going to cost ABC a fortune.
One of the most popular network launches in recent memory, certainly too, right? I mean, we were talking record-breaking debuts for that series. I have not watched a single episode of it, Dan. I don't know about you. Did you watch any of the show? Was it worth hanging around and seeing?
Actually, I have. I grew up watching it when I was younger, and now it was something that me and Elodie would watch with Reese when it started. I love the reboots. I love the Boy Meets World reboot. I love the whole concept. Murphy Brown coming back. I think this is going to be a trend. I think people romanticize about this. Certainly the Will and Grace reboot, very successful. Boy Meets World, very successful as Girl Meets World. At least it was for a couple seasons until they canceled it. But the idea of getting back in there and remixing it up, people love these characters. You don't have to start over again. It's a very cool thing. And clearly, this wasn't meant to be personal politics getting involved with all of it, and the hardship for the other characters that came back and were excited to have this new platform for their career.
Hey, listen, whatever gets John Goodman back in making movies and cameos in movies like Flight or Argo, where he just kind of comes in and just wrecks an entire thing himself like a one-man wrecking ball. That guy's a force of nature, and he should be making movies, not relegated to a paycheck on TV. I'm creatively excited about this. Glad this thing is put behind us at this point. America, maybe time to move on.
Coyote Ugly 2 has got to be coming soon with Goodman free now, right?
That's not exactly what I meant when I said John Goodman should be making movies again. He should be making Coyote Ugly 2. That's enough about Roseanne right now. Why don't we bring on our friend from Oakview Group, Mr. Ray Waddell, helping us here to break down the news of the week.
How you doing, Ray?
I'm fantastic. It's good to be here, Dan.
Stadium season is upon us. The festivals are happening, and you've got all of these big shows. Kenny Chesney, Taylor, everywhere you look, there is another huge stadium show being announced. How do you see business going right now this summer?
Well, you know, everybody I talk to says it's really healthy. And the numbers that are coming into Pollstar, which, as we know, is the gold standard of concert reporting data.
Of course it is.
They indicate another robust year. You talk to people anecdotally. Totally. You hear that it's robust. And I'm telling you, that's from a club to stadium level.
Man, you're seeing baseball and football stadiums producing concert series now with bands like Pearl Jam doing multiple nights in baseball stadiums in multiple markets and selling them out months in advance. I don't know if the business has ever been this healthy.
People were telling me 5 or 6 years ago that stadiums were a cyclical trend and they had gone away. You know, it went away by and large for a long time with only sporadic stadium tours. Now, not sure it is a cycle. I think it's a career milestone to play in the stadiums. Sure speaks to the health of the business that you have acts that can come in and sell 60,000 seats in a given market, sometimes twice. And they're not all veteran acts either. You know, they're your younger acts as well. So you can't really deny that it's a healthy sign.
In the news this week, Live Nation just announcing they're taking Lollapalooza to Sweden. Is there no bounds to where Lollapalooza can go?
I think it's a brand that has really solidified itself internationally, and it speaks to the global nature of our business now. And Live Nation certainly has been international all along. C3 saw the prospects of this brand, and when they revived it, first in Chicago and hugely successful in South America. So they have transcended borders, certainly, with that brand, the C3 guys, and they understand brands, and they understand talent drives it. If it can work in Berlin, if it can work in South America, and certainly if it can work in Chicago, then why not Sweden? Lala is one of those iconic brands that is associated with cutting edge rock and roll. I guess it goes back to Perry Farrell and certainly what C3 has been able to do with it. So hats off to them, and hats off to Live Nation for the international investment, not just Sweden, but you see what they're doing in Japan with John Boyle and doubling down on that market. So international is really healthy, and you see artists launching album cycles, not just for promotion of the record, but for touring around it. It's only so many days in a year, and they're definitely including a global platform on a lot of these plans and these launches and cycles.
Since we're on Live Nation, let's stay there. They announced this morning they're acquiring Scoremore, which is an Austin-based company, and they do festivals, and they really, in the EDM and country space, they really have it going on. They just continue to build Live Nation with their acquisition mode.
Well, I would just say that when you look at Live Nation and Scoremore shows, to me, it looks like an investment in Sasha, an investment in hip-hop and live, and an investment in Austin. So it's a very hot market. Everybody is watching what's going on in Austin. So a very savvy move for Live Nation, and there's a lot of reasons why to do that.
Now, Ray, the business seems one-sided lately. It seems like Live Nation is announcing things every couple of days. AEG seems like they've gone quiet. Are they just not competing on this scale now?
You know, I can't really speak to them. I would say that a few years back, it seemed like they were more interested in investing in permanent things instead of the year-long or less investment of tours. They were more interested in investing in festivals that have more permanence to them and venues. That seemed to be their direction they took a couple of years ago. Now, you know, it's kind of hard to pinpoint what they're doing. I mean, really, I love those guys.
Conference season is kind of cooled down, but there's one big summer one coming up that you guys have?
Yeah, actually, a couple of them. We're going to do MEDIUM. It's the largest international music conference in the world. They've been pretty much focused on recorded content and publishing forever, but obviously they see that live is where the business is, as we've long known. So they wanted to stick their toes in that live water under the Polestar brand. So I programmed a day of live programming called the Live Summit at MEDIUM with Polestar. It's a live day of programming under the Polestar brand. We're real excited about it. We just want to be present on a global basis more than Polestar traditionally has been. We're glad to be at MEDIUM, and I look forward to going to Cannes. I'm definitely more used to the Redneck Riviera than the actual Riviera, but we'll see how I fit in. Then we have our Venues Now conference in June, which is our second annual. You know, if you look at the two pillars of OVG Media and Conferences, my division, you have the content side, which is Polestar, and the venue side, which is Venues Now. So we're real excited about it. Check it out. Contact me if you want to go, and we'll see if I can hook you up or get you involved in any way. It's coming up June 19th and 20th here at the Beverly Hilton in LA.
What's the best way for people to contact you, Ray?
You know what? The best way to contact me is by smoke signals. But tell you what, you can do the email as well, rwaddell@oakviewgroup.com.
Thank you so much for taking the time. It's always great to have you on.
I appreciate yours, Dan, and I appreciate what you do for our business and for shining a light on a lot of things and just for being the sweetheart that you are.
Thanks, Ray.
All right, bye.
Hey, it's Brian Penix with NS2 and ABI Management. I'm going to be on Promoter 101.
It's everyone's favorite time. It's the announcement of our Promoter 101 Badass of the Week. Who we got this week, Dan?
This week, we're excited about our Badass of the Week, Luke. Unlike past weeks, this week is a truly badass with lots of moxie from Live Nation North America co-president Mark Campana. Now, he does so much goddamn business, it'll make your head spin, making him this week's Promoter 101 Badass of the Week.
A congrats goes out to you, Mark. Truly a badass. Another Chicago guy. I absolutely love it.
Hey, it's Elliot Lefko, promoter from Golden Voice in Los Angeles on Promoter 101.
In our featured interview this week, we've got a special sit-down with record biz icon Harvey Leeds.
Now, before we get into this, we want to tell the parents to go ahead and send the kids into the other room because they're going to be more swearing on this podcast than ever, and that's saying something.
That's pretty impressive considering our general level of swearing on this podcast.
With no more further ado, Mr. Harvey Leeds.
I'm with a fucking icon. Harvey Leeds, welcome to Promoter 101.
Well, thank you very much.
We can talk about your epic days in the label, talk about your management career, but dollar for dollar, you're one of the biggest personalities the industry's ever known.
Jesus Christ. I don't know what shit you're smoking, but thank you, and I'm honored that you would say that. Probably the reason you say that is because in this industry, you have a lot of lucky people that are fucking boring. Zero personality.
You created a different world in the experience of dealing with people, and people respond to you. Your years at the label fostered amazing relationships. You're beloved. You're a people person. Can you talk about, in the industry, how being a relationship business, how that's worked for you?
Well, whenever I met somebody, whether it was in radio, a promoter, an artist, a manager, an agent, a waiter, a waitress, the attendant in the garage parking lot, you have to find that common ground. They can relate to you so you can talk to them and you guys have some common ground. And most people, they don't give a shit about the other person. It's just like, I got this. I want that. Let me sell you this crap. I always thought it was about relationships. And because I come from a little bit of a showbiz background, to me, we're in showbiz, baby.
The industry within itself revolved around the record labels, particularly in your many years at Sony.
I would agree with that because there were constant bidding wars. In the sexier later days, it was always Epic Records, where I worked, and DreamWorks, and Geffen. It was like, that was the bidding war that went on. Everybody else was asleep. Now, I think those labels are asleep, and everybody else is wide awake. I mean, look at Atlantic Records. They're on fire. They're flammable. They can do no wrong.
That's because Harlan Fry's there, right?
Yes, and two great presidents, and Pete Gambarg, and Julie, and Kalman. I mean, yeah, they're on fire. They listen to the street.
But mostly about Harlan.
Always about Harlan Fry. Taught him everything I know.
I've heard you guys have that conversation before. It could be an episode by itself.
You know what? Great idea.
The industry has evolved. Your label days are behind you. You've moved into management. You're doing other things. Southside Johnny is your day-to-day.
It's one of my days-to-days and one of my favorite artists. You know, life is cyclical. It was one of the early projects I worked with at Epic back in 1976. And if you told me 35, 40 years later, I'd be managing him and helping him get out of some ruts that he was in and make some great music and do some great touring, I would have told you, you're fucking nuts.
And yet, killing it, particularly on the East Coast.
Yes, but we just went to Japan for the first time. We crush it in the Scandinavian countries. We do the UK. We're doing Spain. We're doing Italy, Mexico. I mean, we're going places that he's never, never gone.
So you got the management thing. You're involved in some other projects. Can we talk about that?
We can talk about a lot of things.
What else are you working on? What's your day-to-day right now?
So when I retired from Sony, Live Nation wanted to hire me, but I had been kissing enough butt for enough years that I said, I really would like to work for myself. And they brought me in the New York office, and I'm a consultant to the Live Nation New York office, which is where my office is. And, you know, I worked with Kevin Morrow and staff, and now Jason Miller and Ron Delsner and Sean Striegel, Jason Stone, Jason Miller, Christian McKnight, Stacy George. You know, I'm sure I left somebody out.
Good things going on. It seems like there's a fight for New York going on right now between AEG, Bowery, Madison House, Live Nation, like gangs in New York up here.
Well, yeah, I mean, look, to say it's a fight, I would disagree with that because I look at myself as Kissinger in the rock and roll arena, and there's Live Nation. They're a big machine.
They are, but in this market particular, there's a lot of assets in the AEG pocket. But I would think if anybody's winning the fight in this market in particular, I think it's MSG. I think Madison Square Garden's got the best assets in New York proper.
Well, to have Madison Square Garden and Radio City, you know,
the Beacon,
but Live Nation and everyone, they're open rooms. Everyone books there.
But no matter who rents, you get the bar. And that's the key to this business. We can have this conversation all day long about the business is this and the business is that, and it'd be a waste of fucking time. You're Harvey Leeds. You get the best stories in the industry. Let's cut the bullshit and let's talk about the history. Let's talk about the cool shit.
I'll tell you a lesson I learned a long time ago. Harvey and Corky Promoters in Buffalo. Harvey Weinstein. I don't know if you know that name. He once was a concert promoter. I think he's now out of the business. He was doing a show in Buffalo, and Boston had broken big. More Than a Feeling was a giant record on both top 40 radio and rock radio. So I didn't really know it in my early days oh, there's a radio station that puts their name on a show. And it was a WKBW, which was the monster powerhouse top 40 in Buffalo, kind of like LS in Chicago, RKO in Boston. So I was friends with the late, great John McGann, and he had WGRQ. And John Sykes was my local promotion guy. And we cut a deal with a local tuxedo company. And they had all these used tuxedos. So we said, well, let's put bands' logos on the back and give away the number of frequency, you know, 104 tuxedo jackets with Boston and a spaceship on the back. And John, you want to bring the band on stage? No problem. So we bring the GRQ truck there. The people almost tip the truck over. I put GRQ on stage. Hey, please, Buffalo, welcome Boston. The next day, the local top 40 independent promoter calls my boss at Epic. Who's Harvey Leeds? Fire him. He just took over and stole this Boston show from the powerhouse top 40. And at the time, top 40 was like king. And we were giving away tuxedos and creating a riot out in the parking lot. And it was like one of the first times I was like, oh, there's this whole other side of the business that I didn't really think about because I was just myopic. And my job was like, I am going to get this song on that radio station played as much as I can. Oh, there's concert promoters, there's agents. And there was this whole other world that
not that you were trying to disrespect any of them. You just didn't.
I was doing my job. I just happened to do my job better than the other guy while he was asleep.
The early days before you knew it all.
Or the guerrilla type wars we would do. I forget it. It was HFS and either IYY and DC 101. HFS, they owned the market, but there were all these great shows at all these other radio stations. So I was like, I got an idea. Let's take your logo and put it on a gobo, and we'll find a building across the street from the venue and we'll project it up there. Well, you can imagine what HFS did to me. In fact, my voice used to be much lower. And now it's like this because, you know, I was just doing what I was doing.
I love it.
I mean, I've always thought about thinking off the screen, out of the box. It's about promotion. It's about personality. The king of all media, Howard Stern. Why is he so powerful? Because he's got a super personality. And he knew very early on that you didn't just play, you know, Ted Nugent in Kansas and Boston and Foreigner Records. What you did was you talked crazy stuff in between it. And then eventually he just kept talking and the records faded away.
Let's talk about some of the names. Over the years, so many amazing artists that you were involved with helping break. Run the list.
How about I'm in the studio with The Clash and they were recording London Calling. And they say to me, hey, you know how to play soccer? Not really. Good. And we go to a schoolyard near the studio and they go, you're the goalie. And they proceed to kick the ball and kick the living shit out of me. But meanwhile, being there, you know, working the first two Clash albums and not having very much success in the United States. When I heard the song London Calling, I was like, game changer.
That was their move. We were going to violate the shit out of you with soccer balls and there ain't shit you can do about it.
I can tell you the time I'm going to say we were in Dallas. They had played some bowling venue there. And afterwards, they're like, hey, let's all, after the show, hang out. It was one of those hotels where the elevators are like those glass tubes, you know, so you can see going up and down. And they had the top floor, locked the elevators up on the top floor, and just sat there throwing shit off the balcony into the lobby of the hotel.
Of all of the acts you've worked with, who was the best live?
The best live? Whew. There were Michael Jackson shows during the peak of Thriller days that were just, I mean, he's, you know, the greatest live entertainer. So in that space, Michael Jackson was one of the greatest live shows you'd ever see. On another level, the greatest punk band, The Clash. But then Rage Against the Machine also, you know, would snap your neck and put you up against the wall. Pearl Jam, certainly, great band. I could tell you there were fantastic Cyndi Lauper shows. Stevie Ray Vaughan, ridiculous player. Jeff Beck, insane. At the peak and in the space that they lived in, Korn did some insane shows. Living Color.
Living Color seems like a band that never truly got their due.
The first time I ever saw a mosh pit at Roseland was a Living Color show. I was like, what the fuck is going on? Why are these people in a circle running up and beating the shit out of each other? I had no idea. And I'm going to say that Lisa Robinson, one of the greatest, you know, rock journalists, I said, what's going on here? And she said, well, that's called a mosh pit. I was like, wow, that's crazy. Yes, it's a form of male masturbation. And I was like, oh, okay.
You know, you've seen the industry go from being single and video oriented, where you needed MTV and you needed radio to break the act, or at least break the single and the album, to MTV not playing music anymore and radio not being a driver in the industry. Now with the change to the internet and streaming and artists making their money on the road and not so much from their album sales, do you feel that it's a better time to develop as an artist? Or do you feel that back in the day when radio could break an act and labels had more control, that that was a better time to try and break as an act?
Well, it's harder today to break an act because the greatest thing that happened to the music industry is the internet. And the worst thing is the internet. Because so many people can make a sonically wonderful sounding record in their bathroom. And so the highway and the competition is so crowded, and it's so hard to come up with that game-changing viral thing that just jumps out. I mean, I can tell you so many acts that I've worked and managed in the last 8 to 10 years that you think you got the magic, but you can't get the traction for whatever reason, because it's something that's organic. You can't manufacture it yet. I'm working with a young lady right now who's 17 years old, a girl from Hawaii, and she cut a song. We put it out. It's a promo for a Fox New TV show called The Resident. It's been, you know, on the internet as a promo for the TV show that's going to January or February. But just from that promo, the phone starts ringing. Who is this girl? And because, you know, her voice is Lord meets Adele meets, you know, Halsey, it just sticks out.
Who is this girl? What's her name?
Her name is Liv. L-double-I-V.
Got it. Let me ask you, you've worked with everybody. Your three favorite people in the industry.
Well, I hate everybody.
Well, we'll get to that in a minute.
My three favorite people in the industry. My three favorite people, they got to be, I would say, Frank Barcelona, Ron Delsner, Marsha Vlasic, Larry Magid. Of course, how could we not include, you know, Seth in there?
Seth Hurwitz?
Yeah. Seth Hurwitz.
Gotta love Seth. On. All right, let's go the other way. Who are the biggest pricks?
There's too many of them. I don't think we could list them all.
Is there a king shit prick that always comes to the top?
A king shit prick. You know, I've mellowed out like a fine wine, so no.
Before we head to the bar and go drink, is there one more epic story you can share with us?
This is a funny story. We were lucky enough two or three times to pick up Virgin Records label at Epic Sony CBS Records.
Is this when Flom was running the ship?
No, way before that.
Okay.
And we had an Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark record. And there was a radio and records convention at the Century Plaza Hotel.
R&R, wow.
Yeah.
That's going back.
R&R. I came up with this idea. I'm going to have every pillowcase in the hotel have Day-Glow black ink on it and say Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark. And I paid off the hotel I had to pay and housekeeping. And so during the day, everybody's pillowcase got turned into an Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark pillowcase. I thought it was a genius idea. Oh, I love this. This is great promo, 101. And everybody went to sleep that night. And everybody woke up the next morning with black stripes on their face and writing and OMD backwards. So some people looked like they had been out in the sun because they'd been rubbing their face with soap and wash rags. And some people that didn't look in the mirror came down. These guys had black schmutz all over their face. But we have lots of those crazy stories like that. But that just at the moment pops out.
You're an endless supply of stories. I would love for you to come back next time we're in town and do more with you if you would honor us with that.
I'd love to. I mean, the problem that I have, and I tell this to clients and new business people like you, I forgot what I know because they'll say, hey, I want to go do this. And I'll go, well, I'll go call that person. And they'll say, oh, you know that person? Yeah, I know that person. Let's call him. And they're like, well, why didn't you tell me? I forgot.
The legendary, incredible Harvey Leeds. Thank you for joining us on Promoter 101.
Pleasure. I forgot who I know.
Did we tell you there'd be some swearing or what? He's an icon. He knows how to swear. And I can't remember a time where he wasn't winning the Label Executive Award at Pollstar. To the point where they finally retired the award. He just won it every year. There was no reason.
Hi, this is Jake Sufnarowski from Rocks Off, New York City's sweetest independent concert promoter. And you're listening to Promoter 101.
Tweets of the Week.
It's the name of the show. We got to talk about it. We got some tweets of the week, Dan. Start here. When you're getting up first thing Saturday with pure joy, then you can work in a totally empty office with no distractions.
No disrespect to my team, but damn, I love it when I'm alone in the office. Just shit gets done.
About that moment when you get to deliver a winning day to someone you truly like. Aw.
Let's not lie. We all have our favorites. I sure have mine. I bet you do too, Luke, huh?
I absolutely do. Ticketing audits that require additional schooling to read. This is fucking incredible.
Can you please just all go with one universal format?
Can we not design something that's been made in DOS? I mean, like seriously, some ArcTicks or even old Ticketmaster things. I'm like, what are we looking at with like seven different K types and holds? Someone should tell the manager to stop putting so many goddamn hold designations in place.
I don't care about the holds. Do what you got to do. But let's find a format that I don't literally need to like be highlighting things and crossing them out and figuring it out like one at a time using my old TI-83 and highlighter to figure out how many tickets we sold in each price level. It's insane.
It really, really is. When a promoter rep totally has your back and makes the show work no matter what the day throws at them.
Shout out to my production team for making this happen. Abe, Rich, Roy, Joel, Tim, Nick, Larry, Alan, Becky, everybody. I got to tell you, it seems glamorous backstage, but all it really is these big cement block boxes that are dark and damp, and it's no fun. It's a lot of work creating that magic on stage, and it ain't nearly as glamorous as everybody thinks it is.
It really is. And you've got a phenomenal team. Huge shout out to some of the people that we've worked with in the past. Abe Nielsen, Rich Sellers, Roy, Timmy, Alan Young, Becky Migas, Larry Rust. You got phenomenal people at Endpoint Presents. And that goes out to all the amazing promoter reps out there who do a great job for all the companies and make our artists, our tour managers, our crew, their lives so much easier. So thank you for that. And that'll do it for Promoter 101 Tweets. Make sure you keep up with the madman himself, Dan Steinberg. He's the Jew on Twitter.
Hi, I'm Mitch Rose, co-head of the music department at CAA, and I'm on Promoter 101.
This week, Dan, an amazing war story from Live Nation Global Touring, Omar Al-joulani.
We've got a war story that I can't wait to hear. Beirut.
So there's a preamble. In 2008, Michael Bolton and I went to Beirut for him to perform at a wedding. My mother's Lebanese. I was really excited. I'd never been. In Beirut, it was a construction magnate. He'd built the American embassy in Iraq. It was like a royal wedding. We go. It's a big paycheck. First class flights. Picked up with cars. Go out for dinner. It's an amazing experience. Nicest hotel. Bolton's room was as big as a football field. We had a great time. Next summer, we're planning Bolton's tour across Europe. Keith Nesbitt turns to me and goes, let's pound the bushes and see if there's a show in Beirut for Michael. He really loved his experience there. So we find a promoter that no one had ever worked with before, but he put up the money, sent 50% deposit. He put the show on sale. And the way the routing had gone, we were in Greece, and then we were in Turkey, and then we were in Beirut. So we were sitting in Istanbul.
Not Constantinople.
Yes, exactly. We were in Istanbul at this beautiful hotel. Bolton didn't want to leave. We only had 50% of the money in from Beirut. Keith was somewhere else in Europe. He decided he needed to fly in and touch Bolton for a few days. So he flies in Istanbul. He convinces Bolton that we need to go to Beirut, that we're going to figure out getting the 50%. And my rule with Keith was always, we're never going to show up to a country where you can't sue anybody if you don't have the money in advance. We broke the rule because we'd had so much fun in Beirut before. So me, Keith, and Bolton get on a 6-seater charter plane from Istanbul in the middle of the night, fly to Beirut. Promoter picks us up, takes us to a much lower version of a hotel than the one we'd stayed in last time. So now Michael's a little bit on edge, and everything started to go downhill from there. We wake up the next day, we go to lunch with the promoter, you know, we're there a day early, we do a press conference, and somewhere at the end of the press conference, Bolton gets invited the next morning to go to the president of Lebanon's house to have a conversation with him about helping bridge the divide between Israelis and the Lebanese people. Bolton's Jewish. And so Bolton was doing this whole, I can help bridge the divide. So I'm now terrified. I've called my mom to ask her, you know, whether this is a good idea. This is now terrifying. We're going to go do some Middle East peace with Michael Bolton. So that night, Bolton and I go out, and he wants to stay up late. And I say, Michael, you know what? They're sending a car at 8 a.m. to take us to the president's house.
Is Bolton a good hang?
Bolton's a great hang. One of the best hangs. We had a lot of fun together, him and I, like Russian mob, great times over the years. Bolton and I traveled the world together a few times. That's another great story. Bolton and I opening a casino in Romania owned by the Russian mob. But so we go out, we're out real late. We get in next morning. They send the cars to pick us up. Presidential seal, super heavy security. I knock on Bolton's door. He's like, I'm not coming. My voice is bothering me. I have to perform tonight. Take these two laminates, give them to the president. Tell him he's welcome at any show of mine around the world. So I go downstairs. I try to get out of going. They're like, no, someone has to go tell the president. So I get in the cars. We go up there. President's like, where's Bolton? He can't make it. His voice, whatever. He says, no worries. I understand. Please hold the first four rows of the concert tonight for me and my entourage. So we call the promoter. He has to move all these seats out of the way. I get back to the hotel. I go to the promoter. I say, okay, we got to figure out getting paid. And the promoter says, no, sit down. A check's on its way here. So a check's not going to help me. I can't cash a check in Beirut. And the promoter says, no, the check's coming. And the bank drinks waiting for you, and they're going to let you cash the check. So I'm sitting there with the promoter waiting, and he sits across from me. I notice he's wearing his bathrobe, and he's trying to intimidate me. He's sitting there. He's got these two big goons there. He's kind of sitting back in his bathrobe, very like Tony Soprano style. The doorbell keeps ringing. They keep bringing in more and more food. He wants me to eat with him. I just want the check. And he starts trying to play back whether the check's going to make it in time for the bank to be open. And so finally the check shows up 10 minutes after the banks are supposedly closed. I grab the check, run out of the hotel. I have security with me, a member of the Lebanese army that had been rolling with us from the president's house. We go into the bank. He goes, the bank's closed. Let me take the check. Check was made out to the agency group. He said, let me take the check and your business card and your passport. You wait outside. He's in the bank for 40 minutes. I don't know what happens. He comes back out. He's got a bag full of American dollars. So we go back to the hotel, put the money in the safe, go to the gig. Of course, the president doesn't show up on purpose. You embarrassed me. I'm going to embarrass you. First four rows are empty.
Empty.
Bolton refuses to go on stage. We have to move a bunch of people into the seats. Keith has now booked this after party for Bolton. We're supposed to pick up $10,000 for Bolton to just show up to some party. We get to the party. They don't have the money. Keith calls us. Did you get the money? I said, I haven't got the money. He says, I'm on my way down there. Keith shows up, punches the promoter in the face. Promoter security grabs Keith, puts him in an elevator, pulls out a gun, and we have a negotiation about Keith now having to apologize to the promoter. Bolton comes running over because he spent the entire night on the couch with the promoter's daughter to try to be the peacekeeper. And we barely got out of there in one piece. I mean, there were guns drawn. We were in an elevator going up and down. Keith's poking the security guy in the face.
Damn, new respect for Keith. He punched the promoter.
Yeah, Keith's a wild man. So that was my wild trip to Beirut. Promoter was so mad at us. I went to check out from the hotel and he didn't pay for my room, which could be the worst thing he did that whole weekend.
Thank you so much, Omar.
From Jay-Z to Michael Bolton, Omar has done it all. We'll have him on the show shortly with a full interview. Watch out for that.
Hey, Harlan Fry here from Atlantic Records, sitting with my good buddy Dan Steinberg, Promoter 101. Let's go.
In our final interview this week, William Morris Endeavor's Henry Glascock, otherwise known as the Crystal Pistol, sitting down with Dan for an interview on Promoter 101.
The legendary Crystal Pistol, Henry Glascock himself. How you doing, my friend?
Doing great. Happy to be here.
Welcome to the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
You have an amazing career that has weaved through promoting some of the coolest acts in country, and now you're one of the biggest red dirt agents in the world. Let's talk about the journey, my friend, because it doesn't wind up at that big, beautiful new office at William Morris. You started in the trenches.
I started off in a cover band playing all Dave Matthews in Athens, Georgia, circa 1999-98.
Did you play guitar?
I did not play guitar. I started off, I wanted to be in a band, and I met an artist on an AOL chat room before that was really creepy. And he came over to my house and said he sounded a lot like Dave Matthews, and he did. And I played harmonica and banjo, and so I tried poorly to imitate the saxophone solos on harmonica.
I don't remember a harmonica in the Dave Matthews Band.
There was for a brief period, and like that artist, I was removed from the band after about 2 years of being in the band.
What was the name of the band?
Our name was as original as our music. It was the Dave Matthews Cover Band. And our fiddle player would later go on to be one of the first members of Zac Brown Band.
Oh, wow.
So there's some success after the fact. But when they removed me from the band, I stayed on as their agent.
Oh, you didn't decide you were done? They removed you.
I thought I was going to have a long career as a harmonica player. And I credit them for taking me a different direction. Best for everybody. And so I started booking all their shows. And I was frustrated because I want to go on the road and have fun on the road like they were. So I started promoting shows as a way to get back on the road.
So you start promoting shows and you weren't doing Dave Matthews shows, ironically.
No, I had no idea what I was doing. And I just would call agents and tell them that I was a big promoter in the Southeast. And I would offer huge $500 guarantees to bring their acts to all the college towns that Dave Matthews Cover Band did well in and bring those shows to the same venues we were playing.
Works for me.
Yeah. Some of the exciting early ones. I think I had one of the first Robert Randolph shows, the War Eagle Supper Club in Auburn, Alabama. I think I booked it 2 weeks in advance, called Frank Riley, sent him a sellout offer for Robert Randolph. He said, you only have 2 weeks to promote this. How are you going to get anybody to come? I said, just trust me. I'm really good at it. And I remember going to the Widespread Panic concert in Birmingham and passing out flyers for about 4 hours during the concert. And sure enough, when he came to Auburn, Alabama on that next Monday, we sold out in advance. It was great.
So then you became Frank Riley's guy for Alabama?
Well, I talked mostly to Matt Hickey, but we would do a lot of North Mississippi All-Star dates, a couple of Robert Randolph dates, some Drive-By Trucker dates, and that led to other things, other artists, and then started doing an artist named Pat Green in the Southeast, and that's kind of what got me into country music. And through that, met Scott Kernahan, who was at the time Dirk Bentley's manager.
And Scott was a legendary guy. He was at Pace Concerts back in the day, one of the early pioneers of country touring. He was part of Louis Messina's team.
Yeah, and then Scott called Jay Williams, said, hey, I want to tour the Southeast the way Pat Green's doing all these country college bars. And so Jay called me and said, hey, I need you to start doing some Dirk's Bentley dates. And this is before Dirk's really even had a deal. And the first show I booked for Dirk's was in Athens, Georgia. And the reason we booked it was because Dirk's, I think, had a girlfriend at the University of Georgia at the time and had him open up for a show. And I paid him, I think it was $50 and two cases of Busch Light beer.
Now, I want everybody to remember the two cases of beer. We're going to get back to this.
After the show, Dirk said, hey, man, anytime you can pay me two cases of beer and some gas money, I'll be there. And I wish I had that in writing to this day. So we started doing Dirk's, and then that started doing well in all the college towns. What Was I Thinking came out and blew up. And from there, I started doing other country artists, Gary Allen, Phil Vassar, a bunch of other artists. And then slowly would have my different friends open up. Luke Bryan was a friend of mine. I had him open up acoustic. I remember one time I had him open for Billy Currington, Tuscaloosa, Alabama, Athens, Georgia. So I started booking all these other up-and-coming kind of local, regional country artists, one of them being Luke Bryan. The cool story about Luke was I had him open up for Pat Green, actually, two nights in a row. And we passed out a bunch of CDs back when people listened to CDs from Luke's publishing company. We produced those CDs by literally using our computers to print them off.
That's who you were burning them yourself?
Who were burning ourselves. And at the end of the show, I got on one door and Luke got on the other, and we literally passed out 250 CDs each night.
That's pretty smart.
Well, a couple months go by, and Luke starts selling out the Georgia Theater on his own. We booked him back there like 4 months later, and he did like 600 people. And then we booked him back another 6 months after that, he starts selling it out. And he had a deal on Capitol Records at the time, and nothing had been made yet for the Capitol Records. And instead of having a showcase for Capitol, Luke thought it'd be a good idea to get Capitol to get in two buses and drive down and see him play at the Georgia Theater. I remember he called me about 2 weeks before the show he wanted to play and said, hey, we need to play Georgia Theater. We need to do it like in the next 2 or 3 weeks. I don't think he knew about avails at the time. And I had to move a band from the Georgia Theater over to a club I booked in Tuscaloosa and pay them the same amount of money to move their show, set up our show at the Georgia Theater. And Mike Dungan and all of Capitol came down. They were blown away that everybody there knew the words to all his songs. And Mike was like, they only know this from hearing him live. And I said, no, actually, Luke and I passed out about 500 CDs 9 months ago, and that's how they all know his music. And he was not very happy with me.
Because you gave away the content he owned.
We've since made up. It turned out worse when his album did come out. Those markets were the biggest markets that he had for his on sale. People were hungry for more Luke Bryan at that time.
You guys built a following for him.
Yeah, it was great. You know, and then obviously Capitol came in there and supercharged it, and he got with WME, and he is where he is right now.
You started promoting shows all over the place. You were driving, you were covering dates, you were doing production, you were booking, you were marketing. You're a jack of all trades, a true independent, just a hustler.
I was hustling anybody I got on the phone because I really was a 22, 24-year-old kid who had some money coming in from a cover band that he was booking. Use that to educate myself how to be a promoter, sometimes painfully so, not doing well on a show, etc. My band did really well from North Carolina down to Mississippi, Tennessee, and Kentucky. And that's kind of the area I started promoting shows in. Anybody basically south of Kentucky to Virginia, south, I started booking shows for it.
So once you got going that first year or two, how many shows a year were you doing?
Probably 50 or 60, I'd say.
Clubs, ballrooms?
500 to 1,000 seats.
You wound up taking a job at Outback when the blue collar stuff was blowing up. Mike Schmerich was the guy everybody wanted to be. You had Cable Guy and you had Foxworthy. All four of them were running around the country, Angle. It was genius. Those guys were crushing. They had Alison Krauss and Down from the Mountain Tour. You came in at that moment.
Yeah, so I actually co-promoted some shows with Jason Zink before I went to Outback.
I'm familiar with Jason Zink.
Good guy. I think I did some Leftover Salmon dates. And then I would kind of mimic what Josh Moore, who works up for Bowery Presents up in New York. He had his own company, Jomo Presents in Athens. And I would take the bands he was bringing into Athens and then bring those same bands to Tuscaloosa or Oxford, Mississippi, Raleigh, North Carolina. I'd try to copy basically what Jomo was buying.
So after being a tribute band of Dave Matthews, you were a tribute promoter to Jomo.
Correct. Yeah. For that type of music. I did mostly the jam bands in other markets. He was the king of the jam bands in Athens. We did a Tim Reynolds show together and I convinced him to buy it and said, listen, I've got the listserv from everybody who listens to Dave Matthews in Athens. We should do Tim Reynolds. And that was a really good night for us. I think it did right over 1,000 people.
Yeah, probably a good, what, $25 ticket back then, huh?
Yeah, I think we did a $20 ticket, if I remember right.
That was real money back then. That was a big ticket then.
I was 24, 25 years old. That was great money.
So it's $20,000 gross.
Yeah, another show I did with Josh, we did Bella Fleck together at the Tivoli Theater in
Chattanooga.
And I remember that show well because at the end of the night, once we settled, we had $20 in profit. And so we had been there for early load in, been there all day, made $20 in profit. And we went to the Waffle House on the way back to Athens, Georgia, and used the $20 to eat at the Waffle House.
That's awesome. We just did this with Rank Repeat. Let's do it with you. Real or rumor, have you ever given bands a couple extra cases of beer hoping they forget about the extra production you were supposed to get them?
Extra stagehands, yes.
The name Crystal Pistol. How did that come to be? I've heard many rumors about it.
My last name is Glascock. So you can, Crystal Pistol came from Glascock.
Real or rumor, some of your family names are like Battleship.
My grandmother had 12 kids, and I was convinced that she ran out of names. And so I do have an uncle named Savage and an uncle named Battle. That's their legit name, not a nickname.
So you go from being an indie that was being very successful. You needed to be augmented. You needed the help of a bigger company.
You know, it got to the point where you're putting out tens of thousands of dollars in advertising money. And even if the show's going to make money, you need the extra capital to be able to just put down deposits on the room, on the arena, on the advertising, on the deposits for the band. I did a show with Dirks down in Nacogdoches, Texas. I think we did like 7,500 people. And I remember the week of, Jay and Kernan were calling me, see if we were going to be okay. And I said, oh man, we've got 1,000 tickets sold. We're going to do great. And we literally sold 6,000 tickets the week of the show. So it was great. I was like, this is blowing up. You know, need to do more arena shows. But I also learned on a couple of the shows that you can lose money really, really quickly in an arena. And so Scott Gernan was nice enough to say, hey, Dirks loves you. I love you. We're going to keep history with you, but you've got to get with somebody who can absorb these, you know, these ups and downs. Because there's going to be some bad shows.
It's a roller coaster. Some of them there, some of them.
Yeah, he said, you know, you have a bad week, it can put you out of business. You need to kind of look at it from the perspective of an entire year. So I went and interviewed with Louis Messina, who set up that interview with me, and Brian O'Connell and Mike Smardak. At the time, for me and my family, I thought the smaller independent place was the best place for me to go. I was friends with Jason Zink. Jason had history with Dirks in the Midwest. And then Brad Garrett kind of had in the western part of the Midwest, had a lot of history with Dirks. And so we kind of all went in together to do all the Dirks Bentley dates for the most of the country.
I heard some scruffy Jewish kid had it in the Northwest. I remember it.
No, I don't know who that was. Tried to cut him out.
I bet you might have.
I got over to Outback, learned a lot over there, that you do have to pay ASCAP BMI fees and you do have to have insurance. When you're a 25-year-old kid and you get sued and you have nothing to your name, it's not in the world.
It's a big deal. What can they get?
Mike Smardak had a lot of money, so he wanted to protect his money. So we had to buy insurance, and rightfully so. So I learned, and Jason was a big mentor of me to tell me how to, you know, it's okay to spend extra money on production. It's okay to take care of the band where they need to take care of. You don't need to skimp on what they need. So learn how to do it the right way, I guess.
The right way. The Jason Zink way.
Yeah, we had a great team at Outback, a great marketing team, a great bunch of people.
Darren Leshinsky, Brian Penix, Zink, you, Kevin Brady, Ted Chapin. The list just keeps going. It's just like Ian, and you just think about the guys that were there. It was just amazing team.
Kendall, Damian, Rick Wetzel was there.
The amount of learning you got to do to be in the hallway with those guys and play ping pong with them in the break room, that is a very cool thing. Not to mention, Mike had all of this experience because he was not a new promoter by any means. He came from the biggest company on the East Coast, which was obviously Cellar Door.
And that 2 years I was there, I learned a lot. It was great to have that experience.
So Mike sells to Jam and the whole thing somehow falls apart. In a nutshell, right?
So for me, I was two things. One, I got a letter from Hilton saying I'd reached diamond status, that I'd spent my 200th night that year at a Hilton or Hampton Inn, whatever was their affiliate.
Anything in the chain, right?
Yep. And kind of hit me that I was spending more time away from my family than with my family. I just had a son who was in the hospital, had a bunch of surgeries coming up. And I was looking at being on the road 200 days a year, thinking I need to figure out something different to do with my life. I can't handle being on the road 200 days a year. So Joey Lee had just left Buddy Lee, started 360 Artist Agency. At the time, he had Miranda Lambert.
And that was starting to happen on a real level. She was supporting Dirks at the time in the arenas, is that right?
Yeah, actually, a lot of the shows we were promoting, we had her on the shows.
Randy Rogers was opening, she was in the middle slot, and Dirks was closing.
Yeah, we did another one, the Jason Aldean tour. his first arena tour. That's about the time I was thinking I need to do something different. Joey Lee starts 360. He says, hey, do you know any assistant or anybody that would want to come over and be an agent with 360? And I said, well, what if that person's never been an agent, but could probably be an agent and might be a promoter? He said, that person probably needs to go talk to Mike Smartak first to see if it's okay. So I went over and talked to Mike, said, hey, Joey Lee's hiring. I think it's something I'd like to do. Are you okay with it? And Mike said, Henry, I'd never hold anybody back. You should go take that meeting with Joey. So I went up, talked to Joey. And Joey said, let's do it. What do you need to get paid? I said, man, if you just pay me what I'm making now, we're good. He said, sounds great. I went down, told Mike, took my stuff into a box, went in the elevator, went up one floor. That's where 360 was, same building, and started my new job.
It sounded like you guys left on very good terms.
Yeah, with great terms. No hard feelings there, I think, both of us. I think at the time, that was a very down cycle for the promoting industry at that point. I think Mike probably, looking back on it, needed to probably thin out a little bit of his overhead. And so it worked out as perfect timing.
So you're with Joey, you become an agent. Clearly that's the fit. You're a salesman. You're true and through a salesman.
Yeah, my favorite part of promoting was cutting the deal. And that's basically what agents do, is they cut the deal.
Now 360 then gets bought out very quickly by William Morris.
So a year and a half go by, and William Morris Endeavor at that point came in and made an offer to Joey. Very gracious that he said, you can buy us, but you're going to take Henry and Risha with me. That's how Risha and I both got over at William Morris. Joey stuck by us.
So now you're working for Ari Manuel and Mark Geiger and the guys that like run our business.
Oh man. And going from a promoter to an agent, I remember the first day I got to sit behind that computer, turn it on and see all the deals that artists have made, see all the deals they passed on me up for when I was a promoter. And the offers they took instead of my deals, very eye-opening experience.
Can't
see
job,
all that.
Huh?
Yeah, I got to see behind the curtain, so to speak.
Now you've been at William Morris for how long?
8 years.
And you've developed an amazing roster. You're the king of red dirt. You're balancing a ton of tours. You're doing a great amount of volume. Any idea like roughly how many shows a year you're booking?
I think I personally book around 800 shows a year.
So on any given night, you've got two or three shows going.
Absolutely. And that doesn't count the shows that Mark Rader books for our guys or any of the other territorials book for our guys. There's a guy named Brian Carruthers that works specifically with my roster, booking those guys, making sure they have 150 dates a year.
So you have so many clients, there's additional agents that were added just to make sure to service your clients appropriately.
Yeah, I mean, they've been really good about helping with the workload. Like, hey, let's do this right. If you need help, let us know and we'll get you the employees you need to get it done.
You have all of these Texas acts that do amazing business, not just in Texas, but they're doing stadiums in some cases in Texas. They're doing business in Seattle and all over the country, but really at the core, like doing amazing business throughout Texas, like it's its own country for them.
Yeah, and we've got pockets like, you know, Arizona. They do Randy Rodgers band just came back to 2,000 people in Mesa, Arizona. Another interesting story. Early in my career, when I was a promoter, I got a call from Ed Warm. And he says, hey, I'm not trying to book a cover band because I kind of screwed Ed Warm over. He kind of built our band. We got to a certain level. We went over to House of Blues with Yerky. And so I thought he was calling to get mad at me for my band going back over to House of Blues. He said, no, I'm not talking about House of Blues. Hey, every time I build up a band here, House of Blues comes in and takes it from me. So I got to go a whole different genre. I need to get into country music, and nobody in Nashville knows me. Nobody will talk to me in Nashville. I've asked everybody I know, and they said the only person they know in the country music world is you. Baron Ruth, to this day, I'll give credit for, got Ed Warm to call me to help book Joe's and get country music at Joe's.
Considered one of the best venues in country now.
Ed and I are still great friends. Our deal was a very cool deal. He said, what do you want to get paid? And I said, if you make money, send me some. If you lose money, that's on you. That was our deal.
Seems like a fair deal to me.
So we did this for a while, and I booked all my country bands I was friends with. Dierks Bentley, Pat Green, Cross Canyon Ragweed, Phil Vatzer, Gary Allen. Those were the first five shows we had. And then we got kind of deep into the country roster where there were some shows that did not do so well. But all the managers would argue and the agents would argue, country will never work downtown Chicago. It's a suburb thing. I was like, you've got this big arena where all the big country shows play. What do you mean you can't sell at a club, you know, 2 miles from the arena? Like, country is a suburb thing. And, you know, Ed did a great job of sticking with it. And the first thing you tell a new act is you need to go play Joe's in Chicago.
Henry, before I let you go, from street hustler to the top floors at William Morris, you truly made it on your own hard work and just amazing work ethic. What advice do you have for the younger people out there that are trying to get into the business?
Get in one lane and stick with it. Think that I jumped around from agent to promoter to agent to promoter. All the bands that I was promoting early on at Outback became the big country artists. Had I been an agent at that time, I could have probably been some of their agents. Had I stuck with being a promoter, I could have been some of their promoters to this day.
You think Outback would have kept those acts, or you think Brian O'Connell and Lou Messina still would have been able to take most of them when it got to that level?
It's difficult for an independent to have that level of a tour for the entire tour. It can be done. When it goes to the amphitheater level, obviously Live Nation has the real estate. And it comes down to, can somebody, just like when I was an independent promoter, had to go to Outback to be able to maintain doing arena level business. At some point when it gets to stadium and amphitheater level business, it takes a lot of money and a lot of capital and a lot of commitment.
Henry Glascock, the Crystal Pistol, William Morris Endeavor, spending time with us on Promoter 101. Thank you so much, Henry.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you for having me.
I just love the Pistol. He's amazing. Henry is just one of the best. Thrilled to have him on the podcast.
Hey, hey, it's David Marcus from Ticketmaster. Get your tickets to hear me on Promoter 101.
Dan, we got some birthdays this week. June 1st, the 7th, 2018.
Friday the 1st, Dave Margolin, happy birthday.
On this Saturday, we're wishing a happy birthday to my boy and home free, Rob Lundquist, the Sweet Wine Group's Ira Sweetwine, and Larry Mazer. Happy birthday from Promoter 101.
Sunday, Mike Miles, Ed Beeson, and the Levitt Pavilion's Chase Wessel.
On Monday, we got Promoter 101's very own, the man who makes Dan and I sound so good, Mr. Connor Merritt, our engineer here, putting it together. Happy birthday to him, plus Nikki Solgit.
Tuesday, 6-5, SMG's Bob Packy, Bill Gardner, Ian Lowe from Live Nation Canada, and the man that runs the business, Andrew Good friend.
On Wednesday, wishing happy birthday to the Tacoma Domes, Tom Alexander, Kyle Wofford, Derek Dolan, Rhino Armstrong, and WME's Brody Becker.
Thursday, Mark Hyman and legendary manager from Red Light Management, Puddles the Clown's man himself, Stuart Ross.
A happy birthday to all y'all from the gang at Promoter 101.
But mostly to Stuart Ross.
We get it, Dan. You like Stuart Ross.
I do like Stuart Ross. Happy birthday to everyone, but especially Stuart Ross. And everyone in Canada.
Everyone in Canada. You get a birthday. They have socialized birthdays up there, Dan. Everyone gets one.
You get a birthday, and you get a birthday.
Jim Glancy, Barry Presents on Promoter 101.
Thanks for tuning in to episode 85 of Promoter 101. Thanks to our amazing guests this week, Harvey Leeds, Henry Glascock, Omar Al-joulani. Everybody tuning in this week. Thank you to the word Canada for an awesome week this week as well, too. That's your word of the week.
And the quote of the week comes from Mr. Mick Jagger. Anything worth doing? It's worth overdoing.
I'll take any quote from Mick Jagger today. That's fantastic. And we're going to be back next week. Same pod time, same pod place. Episode 86 of Promoter 101. We got Mills Entertainment's Mike Mills, Live Nation Dubai's Zed McBool, and three questions from Outer Loop's Mike Mowry. Tune in next week.
Hey, thanks everyone for listening. And we're wishing you sold out shows for the weeks to come.
Cheers.
This is John Giddings and I'm on Promoter 101.
Ba-da-ba-ba. Ba-da-ba-ba.